Welcome to this episode of UXD, where we will talk about Lean UX, measurement and metrics, and why they're useful to making better products. I'm your host, Nazmul Idris, a developer advocate passionate about design and mobile, and Laura is back on the show today. Welcome, Laura.
Thanks for having me.
Lean UX is a way to apply the methods of learning as quickly as possible in reducing the cycle time through what is called the build, measure, and learn loop to UX design. Practicing Lean UX means that you're always validating with users that you're designing something that people will actually use. It's about designing products that are both usable and useful. Laura wrote a great book about this called UX for Lean Startups. Now, measurement is a big thing in Lean UX. And last time you were on the show, we talked about different ways of measuring things using both qualitative and quantitative research. And you explained that quantitative research helps you understand what is going on with your product, and qualitative research helps you understand why it's happening. So I have a question. What does quantitative research actually mean, and what are the right ways of conducting it?
So the best way to learn what you need to know about all of this stuff is actually to read a book called Lean Analytics. It's by Ben Yaskovich and Alistair Kroll. So they cover all of this in a lot of great detail, but I'm gonna do my best to give you a quick overview of the topic so that we can talk about how you can use analytics to build a better product.
That sounds great. Let's start there. So what are metrics and analytics exactly?
At the very simplest level, metrics are the data about our product. How many users we have, how much money we make, what our conversion rate is. And when we talk about analytics, we're talking about the process of gathering those numbers and making some sense out of them.
I see. So metrics are the raw data that you collect to measure key things, and analytics are then used to extract information or make sense of this data. Sounds like metrics are really important.
Oh my God, yes. So without looking at key metrics, we're just flying blind. Metrics help us make better product decisions and understand, you know, whether the decisions we're making are good or bad. They help us to make sure that our brilliant product vision isn't merely a delusion.
That never happens.
No.
Yeah. So now, can you illustrate why metrics and analytics are important with an example?
I can. So let's say you make a fairly major change to your product, like you redesign a product page where you know you're actually selling things. How do you know if it was a good idea?
Well, wouldn't it just look prettier, and isn't that a better thing? A good thing, I mean?
Might be, but what if it didn't convert better? I mean, what if, you know, like fewer people bought the product after the big redesign?
Ah, that's bad.
Yeah, it would be bad. And it happens. It would be even worse if that happened and you didn't know about it.
Ooh. Okay, I'm sold. So metrics are important. Now, what makes a good metric?
That's an excellent question. And again, it's one that's answered in a lot more depth than Lean Analytics. But let me recap here. A good metric has to be comparative, actionable, understandable, and measurable.
Got it. So what does that mean exactly?
Sure. So let's look at what it means for a metric to be comparative. Okay. I'm going to tell you that my conversion rate for my product is 2%. How do you feel about that?
I have no idea. Is that a good or a bad thing?
Exactly. So that's the important question. Now, what if I told you that the conversion rate was up 20% from the same time last year, or it was 10% higher than a competitor with a similar product?
Ah, that's a good thing, since those metrics actually made sense to me.
Right. 2% is just a number, right? 2% conversion. Might be good, might be bad. It's impossible to know in a vacuum. But if you compare that metric to the standard conversion rate on a similar product or to a historical conversion rate, suddenly we can see that this particular metric is better than other similar products, or this particular metric is improving. Obviously, it also works if the number is going down.
Ah, right. So that is so much better than just saying a 2% conversion rate, which means nothing. So you mentioned something about actionable. What is that?
So metrics do have to be actionable. So let's take that same number, right? A 2% conversion rate. And let's imagine that it's gone down in recent weeks.
Oh.
That's actionable. Specifically, the action that we want to take is we want to understand why it's gone down and take some steps maybe to fix it.
Ah.
So based on the knowledge that your conversion rate has declined, you can take that action to correct it.
Got it. I like that. So actionable metrics can affect people's behavior. Mm-hmm. Now, what else makes a good metric?
Okay, it's going to seem a little obvious, but I like to just state it. Metrics have to be understandable and measurable. So if your team doesn't get a metric, if they don't know what it means, they can't make decisions based on it. And if they can't measure it, they can't do anything with it. For example, I worked with a team that wanted to know what effect their product had on call times for call centers. Problem was, they weren't allowed to measure the amount of time that the representatives actually were on the phone. So the metric was inherently unmeasurable. I mean, it would have been great to know whether call times went up or down with each new release of the call center product, but the information just wasn't available, so they couldn't use it or make decisions based on it.
Wow, that really sucks that they weren't able to measure such an important thing. So we've talked quite a bit about good metrics. What would make a bad metric?
I'm going to give you a little quiz. Let's say you create a comments section for your product page, and you want to collect some metrics. What are you going to collect? What kind of metrics do you think?
The number of comments and the number of people that left comments, those might be good.
Okay, well, they're certainly understandable, and I mean, should be measurable, right?
Yeah.
Is it actionable? I mean, like, what would you do if I told you that the number of people leaving comments on the product page on the first day was 1,000?
I have no idea. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? Is that too few or too many comments?
Yeah, exactly. So that's the problem with metrics like that, right? They're easy to collect, but in general, they don't really help you make any decisions. I mean, a better metric would be to track the number of products you're selling on the pages that show comments, because you care how much product you sell.
Right.
You don't necessarily care about the number of comments.
True.
I mean, if lots of comments make people buy more, you might want to make an effort to drive more comments. And if comments make people buy less, you might want to get rid of them. See? Actionable.
Oh.
An even better number to track is the number of sales of products over time on pages that have comments. Do they go up or down based on people leaving comments? See, comparable metrics help you make better decisions.
Now that makes perfect sense. So now I've also heard of the term vanity metric. It seems that the number of comments is a vanity metric. Is that correct?
Yeah, it is. That's a great example of a vanity metric. And for those who don't know, vanity metric is a term coined by Eric Ries to describe the numbers that make us feel good or sometimes bad about our product without actually helping us make any decisions. For example, the graph of the number of registered users of your product always goes up and to the right.
True.
Vanity metric. It doesn't help you do anything except possibly to raise some money from people who don't understand graphs. So the percent of active users, on the other hand, that starts to be a useful metric, right? It tells you how many people are actually getting value from your product and continuing to come back. The percent of active users over time is even better than that because it tells you whether your product is getting better or worse. And again, that helps you make good decisions.
Got it. So how about the number of application downloads? I know that a lot of people track those, and they seem to me like they're a vanity metric. They're not really measuring the engagement that users have with the application itself. Is that correct?
Yeah, they generally are. I mean, unless you're charging for your app.
Ah.
What does it tell you that a lot of people are downloading your app? You don't know if they're using it. You don't know if you're monetizing them, again,
right,
unless you're charging for the app. It doesn't really tell you anything at all about the user experience of your product.
Exactly. So it seems that this is a trap that a lot of people fall into because it's so easy to track these vanity metrics. So what metrics should people actually be tracking?
It's another excellent question. And unfortunately, the answer, as usual, is that it depends. But one thing is certain, you should probably be tracking fewer metrics than you think.
Wait, what? I thought metrics were a good thing.
I know, they are. But only if you're tracking the right ones. So for example, you should always be tracking all of your KPIs.
Ah, so I've heard of KPIs before, but what do they mean exactly?
Yeah, so KPIs are key performance indicators. These are the metrics that actually tell you how your product is doing, and again, help you make better decisions. But one of the really big problems that I see is that instead of just tracking the KPIs, just people track all the things.
Ah, I was actually just thinking that if you collect more metrics rather than fewer, that would probably be a good thing. So what's wrong with collecting too many metrics?
So having too many metrics is almost as bad as not having any, right?
Oh.
It's very easy to start to drown. Remember, the goal of metrics, good product decisions. So when you have too much data, you can end up getting so distracted that you can't actually make any decisions.
Huh.
It's why lean analytics has a concept called the one metric that matters. You'll do much better if you focus on a single critical KPI that you want to move rather than trying to track everything all the time.
I see. So that's actually the case with so many things in life. Too much or too little, if anything, can usually be bad. And always less is more.
Yeah.
Cool. So how do I track the metrics that just matter, that really matter, I mean?
Yet another excellent question. And why don't I answer it in our next episode? We can talk all about A/B testing, cohort analysis, and maybe even some funnels.
Cool. That sounds awesome. I can't wait. So that's all the time we have today. If you'd like to learn more about qualitative and quantitative research methods, check out Laura's book, UX for Lean Startups. It has a lot of tips and tactics for doing the right kind of research at the right time. Laura, thanks again for joining us.
It was my pleasure. Thanks for having me. Go build something awesome.
Cool. Now, if you haven't already, please be sure to join our UX community on Google+. It's a place where we can continue this discussion and you can meet other people who are just as passionate about UX as you are. Thanks for watching and goodbye.